Never thought that there'd be an opportunity in 2016, yeah, because Governor Kitzhaber resigned. And I had been investing in companies. We've invested in about 13 different companies, and I needed to make sure that those companies were on a positive trajectory and we're going to be okay, because I have a dual responsibility. On one hand, I have a responsibility to the companies. On the other hand, I feel like I have a responsibility to the citizens of Oregon. So it was really balancing those two. And then decided to do it and got in. I worked in the governor's office in 2007. We talked about a low carbon fuel standard. I'm a venture capitalist. I brought the guys in and we looked at the analysis of what adding ethanol to gasoline would do. And the analysis is, in some cases, it looks like it might reduce CO2 a little. In some cases, it might actually increase CO2. If you go from, you know, the wet corn and dry it, and did you dry it out in the field or did you transport it wet? And there's all these variables, right? And I remember saying to them, why would I invest in something where there's a possibility that it's a little bit better or a little bit worse? As an investor, you want something that's 10 times better. And I think the citizens of Oregon are just not getting a good return on their tax dollar investments. And that's a great example. Well, here's the problem with the way it went down. It goes down in a short session, a massive bill that has repercussions on people all over the state. And I want people to make more money. I want Oregonians to make more money. At the low end, at the mid-range, at the high end, that's fundamentally what I want to do. But when you pass the minimum wage in the dark of night, in a short session, without calculating the financial impact that it has, I think it was... It's shirking your responsibilities. I believe that the minimum wage increase is going to increase state payroll by about 30%. And the way it works is you take the bottom rung of the ladder and you move that up, it compresses. Now an entry-level janitor makes the same as a physician's assistant. The first negotiation you're gonna have is they're gonna say that's not fair. And then you have to increase everybody on up. And I think if it was put to the citizens of Oregon, hey, we're going to increase the minimum wage, but oh, by the way, it's going to increase state salaries by 30%, people might have a little different view of that. It goes on and on. And it's not the right way to do it. And it was a massive red flag that they did it pretty much in the dark of night with very little input. There was no, as far as I can tell, there was no fiscal analysis done on it. And when I worked down there, believe me, if a bill had even a few hundred thousand dollars of fiscal, it was like red lights flashing. And this one has hundreds of millions or maybe even billions of dollars associated with it, yet they passed it without the analysis. I think there's changes that you could certainly make to it. And I think what we need to do is we need to do a reset, and we need to be transparent. And we need to do the analysis, and we need to have all the data, and we need to have people come in and talk about it and make a thoughtful decision on what we want to do, not rushing it through in the dark of night, again, without the citizens of Oregon being represented. I think it has to be education. Okay. We're at the bottom of the states in terms of graduation rate, yet our, and you go, okay, well, why is that? Well, our school days are among the shortest school days in the country. Our school year is among the shortest school year in the country. Our class size is among the largest in the country. The number of dollars we spend per classroom is about 400,000. Yet about 100,000 of that gets into the classroom. There's $300,000 that we're spending that never makes it to the classroom. And we have to go through and we have to analyze what on earth are we doing, because we're failing our children. We're failing my grandkids. Very, very clearly. And it's not because we don't have enough money in the system. We're not managing it the way that we need to. Well, I think the self-governed model is what we had in Indiana. Mm-hmm. And I think it actually worked pretty well.
Okay.
I think that the trick is higher education is driven by the quality of the professors that you get. The quality of the professors that you get is driven by money. you actually have to have money in order to be able to pay for these professors to have them come in. So it is, there is a direct correlation between money and quality in higher education. We have to get more money into the system. Now, I think I mentioned to you that Purdue, where I went to school, has held tuition flat for the last 4 years. So it doesn't necessarily mean that you have to jack up tuition. It's that you have to look at your course offerings. You have to look at areas where you can consolidate, and you have to move the money to where it's going to get you the biggest bang for the buck. So I actually have a solution for PERS. I think I might be the first one. And I've spent a lot of time talking to actuaries and talking to the PERS board, and here's the situation that we have. We have a $70 billion fund, $90 billion liability, right? That's because we have what's called a defined benefit plan, where we owe the people money whether or not we have that money or not. Right. I want to make something clear. My plan absolutely honors the contracts that we have with the state employees that have hired on to today. They hired on with that agreement, and we're going to live up to that agreement. Now, so what do we do? Well, the first thing is we have to go to a defined contribution plan for all new employees. And that means a 401k type plan, and it can be a very lucrative 401k type plan where you set aside 10% of your salary and the state matches 10% of it, or maybe even 15% of it. It could be 150% match, and it would be way, way cheaper than what we have today. But that contribution would go into a fund, it would accumulate over time. When you retire, you get that money. The second thing, I asked them what the liability was 15 years from now. And these numbers are, I think, a little bit out of date, but it grows from about $90 billion to $150 billion. And nobody talks about that. So it's not just closing the $20 billion gap, it's where are we going to get the $60 billion difference between the $90 and the $150 over the next 15 years? We're not. We're constantly going to be behind the ball. We're never going to get there. So what do you do? As people retire, you hire less people than the number that retired. And what that does is it drives down the total population that you have. It drives down your total number of employees. You backfill with computer systems and tools and software. You give them great tools to make them more productive, because actually in state government, we're massively unproductive and we don't have money for tools like that. Yeah. You do exactly what we do in the private sector. So over time, you will absolutely reduce your not just your unfunded liability, but your total liability will reduce to zero as this 401k system starts to come in, because you, by definition, it's a defined contribution plan and you will lose that liability. And you're going to have fewer employees, but they're going to be happier. They're going to have more tools to work with. They're going to be more productive. You're going to be focused on the things that we need to do. And that actually solves the PERS problem. Well, I certainly do. And part of it was brought into clear focus for me when I walked across the state, which that was in the last election, right, when I was a little bit thinner. Yeah. But I actually walked from Baker City to Portland. Mm-hmm. And I was outside of John Day, and I was walking with somebody. We'd walk for 5 hours a day. And he was pointing at the Strawberry Mountains. They were all burned. And he said, "That's my grandfather's land." And I said, "Well, it's all burned up. And there's trees. Why don't you go harvest them?" He said, "Well, all the land around my granddad's land is federal land, and they won't let me cross the federal land to get to my burned timber." Mm. He said, "I could helicopter it out, but the cost of helicoptering it out was greater than the value of the timber. So every day on my way to work, I get to look at my grandfather's land that he planted those trees and see it all burned up and realize that it's the federal government and the state government, all these rules and regulations that are preventing me from having the economic value that my granddad passed to my dad that passed to me." And people ask me, what did I learn from that? I learned I could never comprehend what that would be like. I can intellectually understand it, right? I can tell you that story, but it is so devastating. I can't describe to you how I would feel if that was what I had to deal with every single day, and watch that. So what do we do? An example of what I do is, as governor, I'd start to talk about trees as the greenest building product that we could ever have. It is sequestered CO2. That's what trees are. In fact, I went to the Sierra Club and did a debate with Kitzhaber and Bradbury. And I said to them, look, I'm a technology guy. There's 1,000 people in Portland. I said, I'm a technology guy. And I heard about this neat new thing. And you can put it out in a field. It's a device that sucks air in one side. It's solar powered, right? Don't have to put any power to it. It does require some water, but the water that it requires, it's rainwater. You don't have to pump any water to it or anything. And in this continuous slow process, it comes out with this fibrous material that we can slice up, we can laminate, we can turn into building products. There's all kinds of wonderful things that we can do with it. And the only byproduct of this process is oxygen, right? That's what it emits, is oxygen. And they said, that's remarkable. You're the smartest technologist I've ever known. I said, well, that's a tree, right? That's what they do. And we have one of the only places on Earth where they grow fast enough and they grow in such abundance that we can create the greenest building products known to man. And if we just marketed it that way, and we talked about it that way, and we embraced it that way, we can create economic opportunities for rural Oregon, and we can create a product that all of Oregon is proud to sell, the greenest building product known to humans. I think fundamentally you need to support the will of the people. I don't personally like to kill people. That's not something that I aspire to. But I understand that responsibility for life comes with the job. And if the citizens of Oregon have voted it in and that's the law, I'll enforce the law. So transparency is hyper important to me. I've been frustrated by it. When in 2010, one of the things that I tried to do is get the state budget and put it up online. And the idea was to crowdsource budget analysis. So if I could get the entire, and this is something that I want to do if I'm elected, is put the budget up online, and you have to have 3 or 4 or 5 biennia budgets there, yeah, so that you could look at the line items and you can see what happened to the Oregon Liquor Control Commission, what happened to the Department of Energy, you know, how has it grown? And then you click on them and you can go down into the detail and you can see the same thing in the detail. We did a prototype of this in 2010. And one of the things that we found was somebody came on, and you have to have a way for people to make comments and tag things, yeah, and that sort of stuff. It's all very straightforward to do. It won't cost $310 million to implement this website. In fact, I did it with about $70,000 of donated software last time. But somebody came on and said, hey, I used to work at the Department of Transportation in Colorado, and it looks like yours is about twice the size of ours. And at the time, we dug into it, and sure enough, even though Colorado is a bigger state, more roads, a little bit more population, our transportation budget was about twice the size of Colorado's. The next question is, why? And what are the line items where it's driving this disparity? And we didn't get to that point. I didn't have the resources to do that. But transparency is incredibly important. And to loop that back, we were very frustrated because much of the budget material was published in PDF files that were images, mm-hmm, not actually, yeah, Excel format. So even though they had all the data, they made it virtually impossible. It's like Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom with the Ark of the Covenant. You know, you put it in a building so big with so many things, you can't find it. Absolutely. In fact, another idea that I have that may dovetail into this is, over the past 10 years, we've passed 5,000 bills, roughly. And I said, you know, if we went back to 2006 and we asked people, what would make Oregon great? I don't think anybody would have said, let's pass 5,000 bills. That's what we need. If we only had 5,000 more laws, this place would be wonderful. right? So one of the things that I'd like to propose is that every bill has a sunset. We did this with tax credits. And I don't really care if it's 2 years or 4 years or 8 years or 20 years. There's probably some upper limit, but not necessarily. And then what would happen is you'd have two levers. One is, do you like the policy? And then the second lever is, okay, where do I have to set the sunset in order to get your vote? Because some people may be willing to try something if the sunset was there. This happened with low carbon fuels, as a matter of fact. I don't think they made the right decision when they renewed it, but and then what would happen is it would sunset. Bad laws would just go away. Nobody wants to take the second vote. Good laws, people would vote on and they'd be put back in. I think that concept, so if you had issues with transparency, right, if people had passed laws about exemptions or whatever, as those came up and you forced people to take the vote again and it's an anti-transparency vote, they probably wouldn't take that vote, right? But the fact that they've been voted in and they're there basically forever until somebody wrenches them out, they just don't go away. I'm a strong supporter of the Second Amendment. I don't think gun control laws are going to prevent the kinds of things that we're seeing. In fact, one of the things, if you look back to the 1950s, the violent crime in the 1950s, that's a time when, you know, I was a little kid and everything seemed pretty good, right? And then through the 1960s, 70s, and 80s, it rose dramatically. And now it's actually been getting better and better and better, and we're down to about the level that it was in the 1950s when I was a little kid. So why don't we celebrate the progress that we're making as a society, where we are doing a better job and we are becoming less violent and good things are happening? And rather than try to come up with some story that we're becoming a more violent nation, because we're not, let's start with the premise that, hey, we're making really good progress. And then let's talk about the areas where we have other progress to make. And let's talk about getting money into mental health and early intervention and those sorts of things. But I don't think more gun control laws are going to solve this problem. Well, I guess it is unique. I actually have had them vote for me. In 2008, we had over 100,000 votes in Multnomah County for a down-ballot treasurer's race. The only other Republican in, I think, forever that had 100,000 votes in Multnomah County was Ronald Reagan. Gordon Smith never got it. Chris Dudley didn't get it. So I actually had enough votes in Multnomah County for a typical Republican to win in 2008. Now, that was Obama's wave year. We had a Constitution Party candidate that ran in that race and took about 5%. And Ben Westland was perceived as a guy from Bend. And I actually underperformed in some of the eastern parts of the state. I still won, but not by quite as much. And the combination of those two things with the Constitution Party candidate meant that I lost. But I think they're ready to vote for somebody. I think they're ready to vote for something different. It certainly isn't working right now. I mean, if you ask people, hey, is this working out for your kids? Do your kids have better economic opportunities than you had? You know, do you feel more prosperous than you did 10 years ago? Do you think the opportunities for you are greater now than they were 10 years ago? It's like, no, 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 no. And at some point, and I think that point is now, they're going to say, you know what? Alan, take your shot. Anytime, anywhere. John Kitzhaber and I talked, if I had won the primary last time, that we'd be very comfortable debating each other. And we actually had, we got to debate a few times in the primary. Mm-hmm. And I thought it was excellent. You know, he for all of his faults, he was a very smart guy and he was very thoughtful about the issues. Mm-hmm. And I thought that it would be a real opportunity for the citizens of Oregon to hear both of us talk, because again, our background and experience is about as completely different as two people could be, yet we both care about the state. So I would hope Governor Brown would do that. It's probably around the fiscal issues mostly, and that is, over the last 10 years we've increased spending $27 billion, yet I don't see anything that's 63%. I don't see anything that's even 10% better than it was 10 years ago, let alone 63%. It just seems like we pour money in and get nothing out. And that's the fundamental difference, is that now they want to pass the sales tax, the biggest tax increase in the history of the state. That $5 billion is going to go in and you're not going to ever see any results from it. You're not going to get anything that you want. It's going to go in to fund the unfunded PERS liability and some of the other commitments that we've already made. The increase of 30% for the state workers because we increased the minimum wage. It's going to get swallowed up in all that stuff. And then they're going to come back and say, hey, we just need more, right? So my whole thing is, let's do a rigorous accounting of where we are. Let's look at where we're actually spending the money. Let's take some of these metaphors of where is that $400,000 per classroom, and let's get the answers for people. You deserve answers. You deserve answers for the money that you've spent and that you invest in the state every year. And then we can talk about, okay, are we spending the money in the right place? That's number one. Is the magnitude the right magnitude? And then number three is, do we have enough resources going forward? What my gut tells me is there's plenty of resources. We just have completely screwed up how we're managing it.
Thanks for talking.
Thank you.